Welcome to the Bigger Pockets YouTube channel. I am David Greene, your host of the Bigger Pockets Real Estate Podcast. Here today interviewing my good friend, my best friend, the COO of the David Greene team, our chief operating officer, a top 2% realtor in Sacramento, somebody who has paid off all of their debt, Bigger Pockets aficionado, Kyle Renke. Kyle, today we are here to talk about how to find soft spots in the market. How are you doing today?
I am doing terrific. Thanks for having me here, David.
Obviously, we're seeing a disruption. There's been a shift in the market. The market is softening pretty much across the board in most areas. But we want to find out where is the market the most soft. If you wouldn't mind, can you kind of give us an update on what you've been seeing lately in the Northern California, Sacramento area market? And then what are some of the areas where you are finding that there's the most opportunity for the right buyers?
That is a great question. I would say, first of all, the way you find soft spots in the market is a lot different than the way that you find soft spots in a supermarket. So you got to be aware that there are differences. There's a couple things that we suggest that our clients do when looking for soft spots in the market, specifically in Northern California. The first thing is, as we've mentioned before, looking at days on market. That's always going to be the biggest thing. But the second thing really is look at where you're seeing specific trends of growth in particular areas. And so if there's an area where a hospital is being built, that would be considered a hot spot. Soft spots in the market are going to be more locations where are maybe slightly outside of that path of progress where you can look for those types of homes.
What are some of the indications that you think people should look for to find soft spots in their market? Is it at price point? Is it at certain locations? Is it the condition of the pictures? Like, what are some things you're targeting when you're trying to find where the best deal could be for one of your clients?
There's a few things that we look for our clients to find soft spots in the market. The first one is looking at the pictures, absolutely. If the pictures look like they were taken with a cell phone or they look like they were sort of randomly just thrown up, homes that have lots and lots of clutter, homes that don't quite shine or they don't have that HGTV look, those are homes that we consider diamond in the rough that we suggest looking at. So that's the first thing, because a lot of times you're going to get less traffic, you're going to get less showings at those homes, and so the sellers are going to be a little bit more motivated to work with a buyer for those types of properties. The second thing that we suggest our clients look for to find soft spots in the market are going to be certain price points. What we're seeing right now is homes that are in the higher end of the price point, a little bit more trending towards almost luxury properties. Those types of properties are going to have a lot more wiggle room than, say, the low FHA-type priced homes that are going to, in our market, tends to be the $200,000 to $300,000. Those homes are still really aggressive and have a lot more competitive buyers that you're going up against. So those types of homes, you're not going to have as much wiggle room. But if you're willing to look in a slightly higher price range, a lot of times you're going to have a lot more wiggle room when it comes to negotiating with sellers.
Can you share, like, if you have any clients that are in sort of the same boat and the difference you're seeing with a seller response at those high price points versus the starter homes?
With those starter homes, especially in the Sacramento market where I work, we are seeing a lot more competition on those homes. So we still have to move pretty quickly. There was a house that was listed for about $299 a few weeks ago, and it ended up going into contract. It got 26 offers on it. So even in a softening market, a shifting market, we're still seeing a lot of competition. And so the conversations that we're having to have with our clients at the lower price points is you still got to be mobile. You guys still got to be ready to move because we can't just assume that sellers are going to take a huge price reduction. The second thing is with the types of clients that we're working in the higher price points, let's say 800 and above, those homes tend to sit on the market a little bit longer. And so if you're willing to go in and have a conversation, see what types of threads you need to pull in terms of the conversation with those sellers and with those listing agents, a lot of times they're willing to negotiate, they're willing to deal, they're willing to figure something out that's going to help them get a lower price point. I can give you an example. We had a client not too long ago who had a property that he was interested in. It was listed at 1.1. We were able to come in and get that property for about $25,000 under the list price, which again may not be a huge amount in consideration of the actual purchase price, but in this market, 6 months ago, that house would have sold for maybe 1.2, $100,000 over the list price. And so Those homes that tend to move a little bit slower, we're now able to get under contract a lot of times below the list. The psychology of the seller has sort of changed, where they're not necessarily expecting to get so much above the list. If anything, they're willing to take something a little bit below the list price.
So this is just going to be like a really nice house in a really nice area, probably a grade A type thing. It's not a mansion that we're talking about, but that's the type of property that over a long period of time is going to hold its value significantly more than if you go after the starter home. And the reason that these starter homes aren't having these really big price drops like everyone's hoping for is there's so much competition to buy them. There are many more buyers that are all chasing after $300,000, $400,000 homes than there are chasing after $1.1 million homes. So when rates go up and houses become more expensive, you're not seeing the price drop on a $300,000 house because there's still so many other people that want it. Where you are going to see it when you get up into the points where there's less buyers that are actually competing there. So what advice do you have for somebody who's thinking, you know, I want a home to live in, and I'd like to be a form of an investment, but it doesn't have to be the world's best investment. And maybe they feel guilty because they hear us all talking about cash flow and they're thinking, well, I just want to buy a house instead of rent. Is this a good time to do that?
Absolutely. If you're looking to buy a house for the long term and you're looking to hold this thing for 20, 30 years, buying a house right now makes a ton of sense. There's a lot of ways that you can buy a house and still offset your expenses. And so what we have right now is we have a lot of different clients that we've worked with that are still buying houses. They're moving into that home as a primary residence, but then they're renting out a portion of that home and house hacking it. And so a lot of times they'll rent out a portion of that home as a short-term rental. So now they're getting some Airbnb experience, but they're not having to buy a property out in Joshua Tree and learn how to invest and deploy 20% for a down payment. But they can buy that house, live in it, offset what they would be paying in rent with a short-term rental and making some money that way. Or they'll rent it out to traveling healthcare providers for a midterm rental. So we're seeing a lot of different opportunities for buyers. And for what you would have been paying in rent, you're now getting by owning an asset, reducing your livable expenses, your living expenses. And number three, you're getting opportunity to learn how to run an asset and how to manage an asset.
Now, you work with a lot of clients that both that are renting and then looking to buy, or buying and have been renting, are going to rent their house out to someone else. Have you seen rents dropping at all, even as the market is starting to cool off?
No, we've actually seen the opposite. Rents continue to go up in a lot of different areas within our market. In some areas, it has stabilized. But if anything, it continues to go up because there remains a very strong rental demand, especially with how much traffic and population migration we're having out to our market.
Yeah, and that comes down to supply and demand. If there's not enough supply of homes and there still is a strong demand for people that need to rent them, it doesn't matter what interest rates do. Renters don't care about that. They're competing over the scarce resources that are there. So what that means for a real estate investor is that even though the price of the asset may be coming down, the rent that you collect, the income you receive, is likely to continue going up, which means that your ROI will continue to get stronger. And that's one of the reasons that I'm still very bullish on buying real estate, because I know, well, the asset price could continue to drop. I can't control that. I don't know what's going to happen. But if my cash flow continues to go up and my ROI continues to increase, it was still a good investment for me. And then eventually, as we know, asset prices are going to go up. So if you see somebody who's like, I've been saving, I've been waiting, I feel like this is a great opportunity to get in there and buy, I finally have some leverage and negotiating power, what advice would you give to someone to get the absolute best deal that they could in today's market?
My first advice is take your time, right? Don't feel like you need to rush in to go find a place, right? So you don't have to go in and just put an offer on something, hope that it gets accepted, and then hope that it works out. My second piece of advice is make sure you connect with an agent that is savvy, who knows the market, knows your goals, and knows what you want to accomplish, and they can actually help you reach those goals. Because a lot of times there's certain agents in markets that maybe don't know what house hacking is, or they don't know what midterm rentals are or short-term rentals. So make sure you work with an agent that speaks the same language as you, and they can walk you through the process as opposed to you trying to go out and figure it out yourself.
What's your advice on an agent that everything the client says, they say, yeah, that's a great idea, we should definitely do that, versus an agent that can push back a little and say, I don't think that's a good idea, I don't think that strategy is wise, or I don't think you're going to accomplish what you're looking to?
That's a great question. I would say, first of all, if you have an agent that's telling you, hey, this isn't going to work in this market, or you have an agent that is sort of pushing back, look at that as a good sign. That means that they're trying to protect your interest a lot of times. An agent that tends to just say yes to everything that you're looking for, or says yes to every question that you have, that might be somebody that is just wanting to work with you so that they can hope that they can get you into a home. And so a lot of times the agents that are willing to sort of challenge you on your goals and your beliefs and what you think you can accomplish in that market are usually the ones that know the most about that market. And they usually have your best interest in mind. So don't be afraid of a little pushback from an agent, because a lot of times that tells you that they're looking out for you.
Awesome. All right. Any more advice for our listeners about what they can do to find opportunity in a softening market? So far, you've mentioned be patient, find an agent that actually knows the area that can steer you in the right way, find an agent that is willing to push back on you, because that means that they have your best interests at heart, not just the commission that they're trying to get, and to go for the homes that other people are maybe not looking at. So that could be at a higher price point, but that also is in the best neighborhood. Anything else you can think of that you are doing right now to find better opportunities for your clients?
The last thing I would say is just have fun. Honestly, the more fun you have throughout the experience of going and looking at different neighborhoods, looking at different homes, negotiating, sort of taking the edge off of the scariness behind it, this is a journey for a lot of different people. This is a journey for your agent, but also a journey for you. And bring your agent and your team in on that journey and have a lot of fun when you're doing it, because this is kind of a cool time in the market. Despite the uncertainty that people have, there's a lot of really cool things you can do with homes and a lot of different strategies that you can use that are going to work out for you, not only in the short term, but also in the long term.
Kyle, if people want to follow you, where can they find you online?
I'm hanging out most of the time on Instagram. You can find me at Kyle Renke. If you want to send me an email, you can always send an email to kylerenke@kw.com.
I am David Green 24. There's an E at the end of Green. If you've noticed an account followed you, that might be mine. Look very closely at the screen name, because there are a lot of fraudulent accounts that are copying us. So make sure that you are following the right person and communicating with the right human being. Reach out to Kyle, reach out to I. If you have any questions about California real estate, we would love to help you. And BiggerPockets would like to do the same. Please like, share, and subscribe this video with anyone you know who might want to buy a house and could be a little nervous about it, not sure if now's the right time, wants to take the plunge, but doesn't know what their first step should be. We would love it if you would do something like that. And then let me know in the comments what you like about the video, what you wish that I would have asked Kyle, or what you want to know more about. We love you here at BiggerPockets. We thank you for your time and your attention. We love being the ones that educate you on investing in real estate and building your wealth. And I will see you on the next video.
See ya.